Jeanette Castillo, Sharon Elias, and they are going to present time use of elderly residents in Ward and Care Home. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Our study is on time use in Ward and Care Homes. The purpose of this quantitative study was to understand and describe the temporal dimension of day-to-day life for persons residing in Ward and Care Homes. The questions to be answered are, what do the residents consider meaningful occupations? What does the use of time affect well-being? How does the residents of the boarding care homes describe their time use? What do boarding care residents say about the passing of time? How do the residents feel about their occupational engagement?
So here's a visual of the file that we used. We posted these on the bulletin board of two boarding care homes. And so we recruited two participants from both boarding homes with a total of four participants in a research study. So on these flyers were details that stated our purpose, the length of study, which included a 1-hour interview and 8 hours of observation per participant. And the participants had to be at least 55 years or older and at least a resident at the boarding home for at least 6 months. And each participant were given a pseudonym to ensure confidentiality. And the staff also agreed to a 15-minute interview. So what approach did we use? We used an ethnographic approach. And what is ethnography? Ethnography is about telling a credible, rigorous, authentic story. It gives voice to people in their own local context, typically relying on verbatim quotations and thick description of events. The story is told through the eyes of local people, in our case, the residents, as they pursue their daily lives in local communities, which is the home. So how do we incorporate this type of research, this research approach into our study? We immerse ourselves in the resident culture. And we, like I said before, we conducted interviews, observations. We did a 12-32 observations. And we also participated in activities. We attended mealtime, we attended birthday parties and, you know, their weekly functions. And we also took photographs of the time spot facts in their surroundings. So we use ethnography because it has too many advantages. It gave us a more comprehensive perspective compared to other forms of research, and also allowed us to observe the participants in their own natural setting, which is always ideal. So in order to reduce and analyze our data, we went through a specific process. We, of course, recruited our participants. We then observed and interviewed. We then transcribed our interviews. And then all the researchers came together, and we compared our field notes and transcriptions, and we found commonalities and looked for differences as well. We then coded our data. And then from all this analysis, we discovered three prominent themes in our research. Number one, meaningful occupations. Number two, criminality. Number three, occupational deprivation.
Okay, so our first theme that emerged was meaningful occupations. They can be described as activities in which a client participates. For example, one participant said, I write down things that happen during my writing time, maybe once a week for a few minutes. Other activities we observed were clients talking with other residents and staff members, eating and watching television. Second, meaningful occupations can be defined as activities that give meaning to a person's life and contribute to one's identity. One participant said, I don't know what the heck people would do without TV. Another resident said, I spend time during the day thinking about the things I have done and what other people I knew have done. Reflection also is a major meaningful occupation. Third, meaningful occupations can be described as activities which the person looks forward to engaging in. This is highlighted in the following statement of one resident. I like to go to the shopping center with my daughter. Even if I just sit and watch, I like to watch people.
A second theme that emerged was liminality. Liminality means relating to or being in an intermediate state, phase, or condition at which they find themselves in. So essentially it means being caught in a state of limbo, being neither here nor there. The following quotes reflect how residents find themselves without meaningful roles. Without occupation, occupational stimulation and motivation for independence, the residents become passive rather than active participants. Some of the residents stated, "The weekends are all the same, with the exception of my daughter visiting. There is repetition." Another resident stated, "Why do you want my signature? I'm nobody. I don't do anything anymore." And lastly, "What games can I play? I can't do anything anymore but watch TV. There's nothing else to do. My hands shake. I'm too scared to do anything else." The third thing emerged was occupational deprivation. This is a state of prolonged preclusion from engagement in occupation of necessity or meaning due to factors outside control of the individual. We found that for the residents, physical limitations made them dependent upon caregivers for mobility. One resident stated, "I stayed in my wheelchair until they brought me to dinner." Also, we found that the cognitive level of residents varied, and this created some difficulties in terms of social communication. One resident said, "There's really no one to talk to. They, meaning other residents, either can't talk or they say nonsense." Thirdly, we found that language created a barrier as the caregiver spoke primarily Tagalog and the resident spoke English. So one resident stated, "The staff does not speak English, so that is not any help. They don't understand." Lastly, the residents expressed that they weren't given ample opportunities to do tasks independently. One resident says, "Joel gets angry when the caregivers try to clean up after her. I'm vocalized she wants to do it herself. It's my job, not yours."
We also felt it was important to get the caretaker's perspective of things, so we interviewed them, and some of these quotes are from them. "Sometimes we play cards or ball outside, we bring Mary and Jewel outside. I throw them the ball and they catch it. You have to remind them that there are activities so they can relax and they can feel like that they are still part of the world. Because most of them have Alzheimer's, they are only watching TV. They cannot do anything. Everyone needs help. If you move Susanna, her hips and her arms hurt. I don't think they really know a time passing. Most of the time, they are getting bored, and that is how they pass the time." These are some of the artifacts that we found and some pictures that we took during our study. This is one of the homes we conducted our study in. There are ramps for easy wheelchair access and open spaces for their mobility. These are two ways the residents tell time. And also, here we have a researcher engaging in a resident in fun and purposeful activities that they absolutely appreciated.
The PEOP model on your left is a frame of reference within occupational therapy and relates to our research study, and that looks at the person, the environment, their occupations, and furthermore, it examines how a person's intrinsic factors, such as physiological and cognitive factors, interact with one's environment, their extrinsic factors, such as social support and culture and values, form a person's occupations, the activities they engage in, to affect their performance in these activities. So these four factors interact to influence an individual's well-being and their quality of life. Well, overall, our research and the following things emerged. First, the need for client-centered occupational therapy services. Second, activity analysis and modification can lead to a larger occupational repertoire. And third, the culture of a boarding care home can inhibit the occupational performance of the individual. And this concludes our presentation. Thank you so much.
Did you find any specific activities that they found most meaningful? Because I heard you talking about that some of you like went in and did different things.
A lot of them they found TV the most meaningful occupation, whether it was every Sunday they participated in the living room, they gathered all together and they watched the church service because they're not able to go outside because they had, for some reason, they didn't really use the access band to their fullest ability. And they also saw grooming and taking care of themselves as a native occupation, since it's very rare and they all usually get their caregivers help most of the day.
These were people who were not availed of the occupational therapist's activities, correct? These are people in supporting caregivers, not occupational therapists.
Correct. The facility did not have any OT.
So it was very busy.
Yes.
And with all of the clients who had Alzheimer's, it sounds as though you were able to get fairly particular statements about occupation. Yeah. I mean, their feelings about what they were doing.
Not all of the residents have Alzheimer's at the boarding care home. A few of them did, but not all of them.
So did you get statements from the Alzheimer's residents as well? Or was that informative at all?
There were a few. I had dementia. But, and a few. Yes, I don't feel that it was informative to use that in.
Any more questions? Well, first of all, I'd like to commend your effort in doing in choosing the research methods, because it takes a lot of like effort and time to do that. Now, having aside for the observation and all that, you mentioned four participants for in-depth interviews. How are they divided into the two facilities? Are they two or
two? Yeah, two.
And then how long were your interviews?
They were 1 hour semi-structured interviews, and so each researcher was assigned one participant, so we could get as much information as possible.
We literally spent 8 hours with them.
Each of us, in 32 hours, we were at the boarding room.
Did you find that, I know that you only have like two facilities, but were there major differences in the two facilities that kind of take on maybe differences in outcome?
They were pretty much similar in terms of physical aspect and the artifacts that were available to them and like activities. However, we found that one boarding care home had more camaraderie with their caregivers because they actually spoke English to them, you know, as much as they could. Whereas the other boarding care home used the Tagalog and they felt left out and this was an issue. So there was a difference in, I guess, relationships. It was more of a family one and then more of a just caregiver and resident.
How do you see your research informing your future research in occupational therapy?
Well, going forward, we're going to be doing a study comparing the level of meaningful occupations people have, residents have in a board and care home versus a skilled nursing facility. So we're going to compare both, and we're also, the aim of that is to find out, you know, if people, family or friends want to find out for their, you know, their loved one, which facility they want to put them in, which would be better for their overall well-being. We hope the information that we're going to have from this study will help us, will help them determine which one would be a better choice for them as far as making their life overall better.
That sounds very significant and informative. And I just wondered, though, since skilled nursing facilities generally have a higher acuity of patients, would you match them? Would you try and match them to lower acuity patients that are still going to be delivered with the boarding care? Or do you think that's not going to be an issue? Are there some boarding care that have fairly high acuity patients?
Well, we understand we're going to take into consideration there are going to be differences, because just within the nature of itself, you have a home versus like a hospital-like setting. It's not quite an acute facility when you're going to skilled nursing, but there are going to be some commonalities, and that's what we hope that our future project will be able to hone in on and bring out the differences and as well as the, you know, the similarities between those two facilities as best as we can, so the family and friends can make the best choice possible.
Any more questions? Thank you very much.